With this lecture, we begin a new unit, Objective Criticism. We shall offer first an overview of the main theorists of this unit. We shall then analyze closely two seminal essays that laid the groundwork for objective theory, Matthew Arnold's The Function of Criticism at the Present Time, and T.S. Eliot's Tradition and the Individual Talent. In this unit, we shall consider a theoretical shift from the poet to the poem itself. In other words, we're going to move from expressive theories, interested in the relationship between poem and poet, to objective theories. That's the fourth and last of our perspectives, which is interested in the relationship between the poem and itself. And you'll really understand what that means by the end of this unit. Now, this shift to objective criticism or objective theories begins in the critical essays of Matthew Arnold and T.S. Eliot. That's what we're going to do in this lecture. Now, although Arnold the poet was strongly romantic, Arnold the critic sought to replace the romantic focus on feeling with a renewed focus on ideas. Matthew Arnold's a fascinating character because his career breaks smoothly into two halves. The first half of his career is all poetry. At a certain point, he stops writing poetry completely and begins to write prose. His poetry is all exceedingly romantic and melancholy and overwrought, and he was never able to move beyond that. So finally, it's as if Arnold gave up on the poetry and turned to criticism. And whereas, as I mentioned, his poetry is romantic, his criticism turns away from romanticism in many ways, wants to go back to ideas, sort of like a return to the 18th century in some ways. Arnold, as a Victorian sage who attempted to set aesthetic standards for his age, harkens back to the systematic theories of Pope and Burke. So we go back to this neoclassical idea of the critic setting a taste, a kind of refined aesthetic taste. Arnold is going back to that idea of the critic and of the poet as well. Now, Eliot, writing half a century later, and Eliot will take us into the 20th century, continued this de-romanticizing of theory, moving away from romantics. In fact, Eliot will argue that poetry is essentially a depersonalizing process. And we'll see that in the second half of this lecture. Now again, in this lecture, we shall consider the theories of Arnold and Eliot in two ways, both in their own right, critics just in their own right, but also I'm going to look at them as precursors of what we're calling here objective theory. All right, that's this lecture. Then in lectures 18 and 19, we shall turn our focus to the full flowering of objective theory in the 20th century American school of new criticism. Through a close look at essays by I.A. Richards, John Crow Ransom, W.K. Wimsatt, and Cleanth Brooks, we shall explore the new critical belief that each poem is a self-contained, self-referential artifact. We will see in lectures 18 and 19 how they turn the poem into its own little universe. That's pure objective theory. We shall also discuss how the new critics created a special aesthetic space for poetry that would preserve it from all external forces. In other words, the new critics are what we might call neo-Kantians. Just like Immanuel Kant, they want to create a separate aesthetic place. It's a different kind of thing, poetry. We'll see that as well in lectures 18, 19. Finally, in those lectures, we shall discuss the battery of new tools and methods that the new critics taught us to use when explicating poetry. New criticism is very practical and pragmatic. It gives us rules and methods and tools. That will be lecture 18 and 19. Finally, in lecture 20, we will turn or take up the archetypal theories of Northrop Frye. Now, although Frye, like the new critics, kept his eye on the internal structure of the poem, he delved even deeper to uncover vast mythic networks. And so in the last lecture of the unit, we'll widen our perspective to look at this, again, this large-scale mythic view of poetry. In studying Frye's theories, we will also view him not only in the context of objective theory, but in the context of Christian typology and allegory. And that is something I skipped. That's a medieval thing. I'm going to go back to it now because it's linked to Northrop Frye. Finally, in all four lectures of this unit, you might want to watch for this, we shall focus on how theorists since Arnold have increasingly emphasized the importance and centrality of criticism itself. Starting with Matthew Arnold, the critic comes into his own, and he's only gotten more and more important as we've moved to the end of our century. All right, let's turn to Matthew Arnold. In his seminal essay, The Function of Criticism at the Present Time, Arnold argues for the central role of the critic in fostering great literature. Arnold begins his essay by asserting that criticism is a positive, noble task. And this he agrees with Alexander Pope, but he's even more full about this. And, you know, even today, a lot of people look down on critics. For many people, critics are like parasites. They're like lawyers. I hope I'm not offending any lawyers. But a lot of times people look down at critics as, again, sponges, sort of. Well, it was even more so in Arnold's time. He wants to say criticism is positive and noble. Now, like Pope, he does agree that finally the creative faculty is superior to the critical. But still, he insists strongly that criticism is a worthwhile endeavor. It is worth doing. It is good. It is noble. Here's a little explanation he gives. Matthew Arnold says that all people have the need to exercise what he calls free creative activity. Indeed, he says, the exercise of this power, free creative activity, constitutes man's greatest joy. Now, if you're thinking back to Lecture 11 and Schiller, this idea of the play drive in Schiller is very similar to free creative activity. Our need to sort of expand our mind, to synthesize ideas, to move out, to think, that's called free creative activity. Now, the problem is that not all men exercise this power through the production of literature. Very few of us are great poets. And so if the only way to exercise free creative poetry, which is the greatest joy of man, is through, free creative activity is the only way to get to joy, then there's going to be very few happy people, because very few people are poets. So what Arnold tells us is that for many people, criticism functions as their main outlet of mental play. Not everybody's a poet. Sometimes criticism can be a way to exercise free creative activity. Now, Arnold distinguishes carefully between the creative and critical faculties, shows us the difference. Now, whereas the creative faculty most expresses itself in the synthesis of existing ideas, it is the critical faculty that creates these ideas. Let's see how this works. Critics create new ideas, you know how they do it? Through analysis and discovery. By seeing objects as they are. So critics use analysis and they look at the object and want to see it as it is. They're very clear-minded, almost scientific in a way. Isn't that different than poets? Romantic said poets are interested in synthesis and they're interested in perception, in how things are perceived by poets, not as how they are. So now Arnold's doing something interesting. Criticism is analysis, poetry is synthesis. Now, the critic is not to be disparaged, as he so often was, by romantics. And why did romantics spurn critics? Because they privilege synthesis and subjective perception over objective analysis. So, you know, even Wordsworth later in life said, I shouldn't have wasted my time with criticism. I'm glad he did waste his time with criticism. But even he turned, that's sort of a romantic thing, almost a romantic myth, turn away from analysis. Now, if you're listening carefully, notice what else he does. What he's saying now, if the critic does analysis to prepare the way for the poet, then the critic is the one who offers raw material to the poet. It's almost like the critic is the primary imagination and poetry is the secondary imagination, if we want to think it there. So it's the critic who comes up with new ideas. It's the poet who uses those ideas. Let me explain more fully the way Arnold does. Arnold carries this distinction between critic and poet into a wider aesthetic view of history by distinguishing between two epochs or ages in what we might call the life cycle of a culture. There are two different epochs. The first epoch is called an epoch of expansion. Well, there's really no first and second here. But an epoch of expansion is one in which a culture is rich with new and fresh ideas. It's an epoch of expansion because ideas are expanding. They're lively. They're full of life. They're vivacious. Now, during such epochs, poets are needed to harness this intellectual energy and convert it into great works of art. Let me put it in Shelley's way. Poets are needed to embody the zeitgeist, right? To embody the spirit of the age. Now, Arnold tells us, unfortunately, that such epics are rare. Very few epics. In fact, Arnold really only identifies two. and most people would agree with him. The first is Periclean Athens, the Athens of Pericles. In other words, the 5th century BC, the age of Aeschylus, Sophocles, and Euripides. The second one, you might guess, is Elizabethan England, the age of Shakespeare, the British Renaissance. Those are really the only two he sees as full-fledged epics of expansion. Oddly, Arnold, unlike Shelley now, did not consider the Romantic Age, that which was born of the French Revolution, to be an epic of expansion. He didn't think. He thought it almost was, but it failed. Instead, he considered his age, and remember, he's still thinking of himself as a romantic until we really think of themselves as Victorians. He considered his own age to be an epic of concentration, an age in which ideas are stagnant and the free exchange of ideas is stifled. So if you think about concentrated in terms of stifled, like a swamp or something, that's what he means by an epic of concentration. There's no new ideas. They've grown stagnant and cliched and old. Well, you might be thinking now, might come up with the idea before I say it. Just as poets are needed to harness the energy of epics of expansion, just so critics are needed during epics of concentration to help create and foster a free flow of ideas that will initiate a new epic of expansion. So see, in epics of concentration, the poet can't do anything because there's no new ideas. You need the critic to create new ideas through analysis and objective observation. I think it's a fascinating idea. Now, for Arnold, great literature is the product of a creative fusion between a great poet, quote, the man, and an epic of expansion, quote, the moment. Just being a great poet is not enough. You've got to be a great poet living in an epic of expansion. Because if you're not living in an epic of expansion, there will not be the raw material for you to write your great poetry. All right, let's be a little bit critical of Matthew Arnold. I think it's very possible that the reason he invented this idea was because he wanted to give us an excuse for why he wasn't a great poet, right? He tried to be a great poet and failed. His poetry is still worth reading, but he's not on the level of a Wordsworth or anything. Maybe what he's doing is saying, hey, the reason I couldn't be a great poet is because here I am stuck in this epic of concentration. So let me turn to criticism and do something. Now, even if it's true that that's his motivation, I still think the system makes a lot of sense and really works. I think there are ages when poetry flourishes more because there's new ideas. Again, epics of concentration need the analysis of criticism, whereas epics of expansion need the synthesis of poetry. Again, it is not enough to be a gifted poet without the fresh ideas available in an epic of expansion. The poet will lack the necessary raw material for great art. What is the upshot of this? The upshot is that poets and critics are interdependent. They need each other. Without the critic, there can be no poet. Without the poet, there's not much reason for the critic. So they are interdependent. A notion, and this notion helped set off a steady increase in the role and status of the critic. Now, I would say, and I'll say this later, I think we've gone a little bit overboard. We've made the critic too much. Arnold would still say that the critic is the handmaiden of the poet, like Alexander Pope did. But again, he opened the way, and nowadays criticism sometimes takes itself more seriously as greater than poetry. All right, if criticism is so important for Arnold, what is criticism? Well, Arnold luckily gives us a very famous definition of what criticism is. And I'd encourage you to memorize this, because this is a great definition. Criticism, to Arnold, is a disinterested endeavor to learn and propagate the best that is known and thought in the world. There's two parts to that, the disinterested part and the part about the best that is known and thought. Let's look at the disinterested part first. Now, the word disinterested, as opposed to uninterested, signifies a critical approach that is removed, objective, and free from all political agendas. It's not uninterested. It doesn't say, I don't care. Disinterested means that, again, it's above these things. It doesn't worry about political agendas and ideologies. It rises above. It's objective and removed. Notice this has a little bit of touch of Kant here. This idea of poetry. Basically what Kant says about poetry, he says about criticism. But it is aesthetic criticism, after all. Criticism is free from all agendas. Criticism, Arnold says, constitutes a higher kind of curiosity. A free play of mind that follows the flow of ideas wherever that flow may lead. Now, you'll remember again in my Schiller lecture, I actually got you thinking about Arnold when I said Arnold got upset because in his day, in the British language, curiosity had a negative connotation as something childish. But in France, it's got a good reputation as something intelligent adults do. Well, here's where this comes from. Curiosity is a good thing. It's linked to the free play of mind. It is criticism. Now, Arnold was upset with the critics of his day because he felt that they were too partisan. We've heard a lot about partisan politics these days, haven't we? They only engaged in as much free play of mind as their party platform allowed. In other words, there were lots of great journals in Britain during this time, but some of them were Tory journals and some of them were with other different parties, okay? Tories and Whigs, excuse me. Just like we have Republican and Democrat, they had Tories and Whigs. A little bit different, but there were two main parties. And each party had journals that were linked to that party. And so what would happen was, if you were writing for a Tory journal, you would only allow as much free play of mind as fit in with the Tory political agenda, and the same thing with the Whig agenda. For Arnold, criticism has got to rise above any kind of party politics or partisan ideologies. Again, it's linked to this British negative view of curiosity. They think, that's just childish. Criticism has got to be pragmatic. It's got to be linked to a party. No, true criticism has to be free. It has to be free to explore. If it's linked to a platform, it's not free. For Arnold, what I'm saying, criticism has a value that transcends pragmatism. That's very Kantian. Indeed, it even transcends narrow national boundaries to interest itself in the culture and traditions of all Europe. In other words, criticism not only cannot join the bandwagon of Tory or Whig, it also cannot get involved in any British jingoism that says Britain is better than France, better than Germany. Criticism must truly be disinterested and treat all European literature with equal respect. Now, in addition to propagating new ideas to inspire poets, the job of the critic includes identifying, again the definition, the best that is known and thought. And that's why the critic has to be free to explore all of Europe, because England doesn't have the sole authority on the best that is known and thought. You've got to go out. Now, this tends to be pretty European. We could expand it to Asia or something, but he's thinking in a European context here. You've got to be open to all the literature throughout Europe if you're going to identify the best that is known and thought. Now, by the best, what Arnold means is what we today call the canon, or the great books of the Western world. You know what I mean. Those by Homer and Dante and Shakespeare and Chaucer, etc., etc. In other words, the canon, the great books, which have traditionally formed the core of humanistic studies. Until fairly recently, everybody accepted this was the Western tradition and this is what we should study. Now, Arnold firmly believed that these works in the canon, and canon is like the canonical books of the Bible, that's where we get the word, the canon. Arnold firmly believed that such works were aesthetically superior and that they could be shown to be so, to be superior, by objective, disinterested criticism. In other words, he believed that you could prove that certain books belonged in the canon through objective, non-political criteria. He basically believed it was self-evident. It was obvious. And most people, I think, feel that way too, but many critics today, modernists and postmoderns, totally disagree with Arnold. They view the canon as a product of socio-political forces that determine what is acceptable and what is not. I'll use the phrase you all know. Everything's in the canon not because it's great, but because it was written by dead, white, male, heterosexuals. We've heard this before in that vernacular there. In other words, what modern and postmodern people often say is that those things are not in the canon because they are aesthetically, objectively superior, as Arnold claims, but because they're politically correct to that time period. So, as you can imagine, Arnold is a huge bugbear of modern and postmodern theory. And guess what? Eliot is also a bugbear, because Arnold and Eliot are at one in their view of the canon. In fact, they helped to sort of organize the canon. I mean, people knew what it was already, but they helped to get it as a system, sort of, in school. So Arnold and Eliot are, in many ways, out of favor because of their canonical view of literature and just Western tradition in general. Well, let's turn to Eliot now. In his very short but very influential essay, Tradition and the Individual Talent, Eliot develops Arnold's canonical views while extending the anti-romantic move away from subjective feeling. If Arnold is a little bit anti-romantic, Eliot is very much anti-romantic. He continues it. And remember, we're jumping about 50 years now. We're now into the 20th century. Eliot, in this essay, replaces the romantic emphasis on spontaneity, originality, and novelty with a new focus on history, culture, and tradition. Again, nowadays, most of us take for granted that poetry is self-expression and originality is an end in itself. Well, Eliot is sort of a break. We've kind of gone back to romanticism. Eliot is between the romantics and us, and Eliot tried to take us back to a more traditional view where history and culture and tradition are the bedrock of poetry and aesthetics in general. Rather than break with the traditions of the past, Eliot argues, the real great poets carry the past inside them as a living, timeless tradition that is ever contemporaneous. True poets, Eliot says, don't break with the past and say, oh, I'm original and novel. They carry the tradition inside of them. In fact, they believe the tradition is contemporaneous with them. It's like Homer and Shakespeare are contemporaneous with them, ever true, ever real. Great poets, in the Eliot sense, are conscious both of the pastness of the past and its presentness. I love reading Eliot's prose because Eliot, being a poet, always has these witty, little pithy statements like that. Not only the pastness of the past, but its presentness. The past, the tradition, is a living thing to great poets. They realize, great poets, Eliot says, that their own poetry only has full value when it is viewed within the context of all the poetry that has come before. In other words, it only has meaning within the tradition, within the canon. Once we break away from the canon, in a way, it's not great literature anymore, because the tradition defines that. Again, this is a very traditional, conservative way to look at literature. Indeed, Eliot says, great poets privilege what he calls the mind of Europe over their own individual minds. That's very anti-romantic. For their, quote, historical sense teaches them that if they know more than the dead poets, it is only because the poets are what they know. None of this pride, oh, we know more than Homer. Yeah, we know more than Homer because we know Homer. That's the only reason we're smarter, quote, or more progressive than him, because we have Homer in our bones. I like that, the way he states that. All right, another thing Eliot does in terms of this anti-romantic move, he alters the expressivist belief that poetry is self-expression. I've said many times now that that's often taken for granted now. Eliot tries to move away from this idea of poetry as self-expression. Indeed, he says that the poet is not the source of poetry, but a site for the creative process. Poets are not the origin, like in expressive theories, the poet's not the origin. What the poet is a site, a place where poetry happens. In a wonderful, famous metaphor, Eliot says that the poet is a catalyst that facilitates the fusion of external emotions without himself being involved in the emotions or affected by the fusion. I bet you all know what a catalyst is from high school. You have two compounds, let's say sodium and chloride or something like that. You put them together, nothing happens. Then you take a little piece of metal and you stick it in there, and all of a sudden a reaction occurs. The two on the go, whoosh, they form a new compound, but then you know what you do? You take the catalyst out and nothing has happened to it. It started the reaction, but it is unchanged. Eliot, and this is very scientific, isn't it? Eliot is saying that's what a poet is like. The poet is the place where a poetic thing or process happens, but he's not really a part of the process, which is what the romantic would say. Poetry, that is not the expression of a strong personality, as it was for the romantics, but it is the continual extinction of personality. The poet actually has to move away from his personality so it won't get in the way of the poetic process. And again, it's an artistic process rather than a subjective perception. Or, to give another famous quote, the poet is a medium and not a personality. He's a person where something takes place, not a personality. Now, here is where I said Keats's negative capability is going to come in important. This is a little bit like Keats's negative capability, that the poet has to push away his personality and just receive. So it's a little bit like that, and I think Eliot's playing on that idea. Now, The key to that process, that artistic process, is not the creation of new emotions. Poets do not create new emotions out of nowhere. That's not the role of poetry, as some people would say. Rather, poetry is a fresh fusion of these emotions with objects, experiences, and states of feeling. In other words, what happens in the poetic process is that the poet allows the same old emotions to fuse with new objects and experiences and ideas to create a new whole. Now, this artistic fusion, this artistic process, Eliot calls it a concentration. Don't confuse it with epics of concentration. This fusion, this concentration, he expresses it, Eliot expresses it, in a famous phrase from another essay he wrote called Hamlet and His Problems. Now, that essay has been kind of forgotten except for one thing. In that essay, in two sentences, he defines this phrase called the objective correlative. So like negative capability, he spends two sentences, and we spend the next 20, 50, 100 years at figuring it out. Now, you know what I believe? I believe Eliot knew that was going to happen. I think he wanted to have his own negative capability that we keep talking about it. I think he's self-conscious. I don't know. But anyway, what is an objective correlative, and what does it have to do with the artistic process? All right. An objective correlative is an external object, situation, or chain of events that parallels or correlates to an internal emotion. Now, let's think about it. Much of poetry is about emotion. Eliot would say yes. But emotions are abstract. You can't see them, smell them, taste them, touch them. So how do you put emotions in a physical form? Poetry is physical in a way. Well, what you do is you find something objective that correlates to that emotion. And now you've found a way to concretize it. Well, what happens in the poetic process is that the emotion is fused together with the objective correlative, and as a result is externalized and concretized. Again, the poet functions as the site of this fusion of external and internal. Site, medium, catalyst, all the same idea for Eliot. Now, I want to end in the last 2 minutes by giving you an example of an objective correlative. This is not Eliot's example. This is my own because I think it's better than the example he gives in the Hamlet essay. All right, think about Homer's Iliad. The Iliad is supposed to be about what? The wrath of Achilles. That's supposed to be the theme of the Iliad. That's the beginning of it. Now, the wrath of Achilles really refers to when Hector, the Trojan, kills Achilles' best friend, Patroclus. Many of you know the story. Well, when that happens, Achilles wants to rush into the battle and kill every Trojan he sees. Especially Hector. But there's a problem. At this point in the epic, Achilles has no armor. Hector stole the armor from Patroclus, who was wearing Achilles' armor. We won't get into the plot. But basically what happens is that Achilles wants to go in, but he can't go in yet. But he's full of anger. Well, Homer's got this problem. How am I going to express this wrath of Achilles? How am I going to concretize it? You know what he does? Achilles can't fight, so what he does is he walks up to the battle front, to the front of the battle, and lets out a roar, a battle scream. And his battle scream is so terrifying, Homer says, that immediately about 7 or 8 Trojans throw themselves on their own spears and die. Man, I wish people got that wild when I threw a tantrum. Now, is that not an objective cross? What better way to capture physically the insanity of his wrath than the fact that his mere scream will kill people? You know, there's another example that's even better. A little bit later, once he goes into battle, Achilles is killing all these people and throwing them into the river. And he throws so many bodies into the river gets choked with blood, and the river starts fighting Achilles. And there's a scene where Achilles is fighting the waves. A wonderful objective correlative for the madness that goes on when we're caught up in wrath and anger. That's an objective correlative. All right, as I promised, in the next lecture, we will move on to look at the American School of New Criticism.